So have you heard? My name is Zack Newsham, and I'm presenting a work specifically on the impact of community structure on satsable performance. This form was part of my master's thesis and was done in collaboration with my supervisors, Vijay Ganesh and Sebastian Fischmeister, as well as Gilles Demard and Lawrence Amon. So there's been a number of different approaches proposed to software engineering, such as form methods, program analysis, automated testing, and program synthesis. What all these methods have in common is that they can take the program under analysis, convert them to a set of constraints, and then pass those constraints to a SAT solver. One reason you might want to do this is it allows a separation of concerns so your developer can focus on their core competencies, such as developing a program reasoning tool. In this scenario, the tool would take as input a program and a specification, convert it to a logical formula, invert the formula, give it to a SAT solver, which would then either give a proof of correctness or generate a counterexample that can be converted into a fault-revealing test. Some concrete examples of using SAT in software engineering are things like verification. SAT solvers have been used to verify the correct behavior of hardware designs prior to production. They've also been used to verify cryptographic primitives, such as AES. In addition to this, they've been used for malware analysis, reverse engineering, and automated exploit constructions. More specific to testing, SAT solvers have enabled the development of concolic testers. These are programs that can provide a guarantee of 100% code coverage with a minimal test set or automatically find dead code. They also provide isolation testing and event tracing. More formally, a SAT solver takes as input a logical formula and will return either satisfiable or unsatisfiable. We say that a formula is satisfiable if there is an assignment to the variables in the formula such that it evaluates the true. The Boolean satisfiability problem is NP-complete, but we have noticed that in some situations it can be incredibly efficient. This has enabled some really novel software reliability approaches to be developed. In the last decade, there have been enormous improvements in SAT solver performance, and every time there's a 10x improvement in performance, there are new applications that are developed that relies on that performance improvement. So for example, there's bounded model checking, concolic testing, and more recently, constraint-based programming languages. One of the scenarios we've noticed that SAT solvers are particularly efficient at dealing with is in industrial instances, examples of which are code that's been converted into SAT formulas. We found that this is true for instances taken from a diverse set of applications, and in some cases they have tens of millions of variables and clauses, so we don't think that this is purely based on the size of the formula. We're not entirely sure why it is that these instances are so efficient when they're so huge. The question is some theoreticians and practitioners alike for a number of years, and answering it may lead to better solvers, which in turn will lead to better solver-based applications. There have been some previous works on defining the structure of a SAT instance. In the early 2000s, there was a work that showed that random instances with a clause-to-variable ratio of approximately 4.25 were particularly hard for SAT solvers to solve. Unfortunately, this was only true for random instances and did not explain the power of CDCL solvers for industrial instances. An additional result showed that the industrial instances have a community structure, and I'll go on to define what a community structure is later on. And finally, there was a large successful predictive model that became the basis for a machine learning-based predictor. So part of my research is to answer the question of why are SAT solvers efficient for solving industrial instances? We know that SAT solvers exploit some kind of hidden structure. We don't know what it is. It's led to these three questions. What is the structure of an industrial instance that the solver has exploit? What evidence is there that connects the structure to the performance? And how did the solvers go about exploiting the structure? So this talk, we're going to focus on answers to questions one and two. The take-home message from this talk is that the community structure of a SAT instance strongly affects the solver performance. The community structure is a metric we call Q, which defines how easily it is to separate the graph into clusters. We're currently working towards a small predictive set of features that forms the basis for a complete explanation. Unfortunately, we don't have this yet. Our take-home message is supported by three concrete results. The first is that hard random instances typically have a low Q value of between 0.05 and 0.13. The second is that the number of communities and the Q value of SAT instances is more predictive of SAT solver performance than other metrics we've considered, such as number of clauses and the number of variables. And we've also seen that there's a strong correlation between the community structure and the literal block distance in the glucose solver. So I've covered the reason why it is that SAT solvers are important in the software engineering domain and why we want to capture the structure that's inherent with these industrial instances. I'm going to go on to define what the community structure is in a graph, and then we'll look at the results. So when we talk about the community structure of a SAT formula, what we mean is we take this SAT formula and we convert it to the variable incidence graph, where a variable in the formula becomes a node in the graph, and we create an edge between two nodes if those variables appear in a clause together. A community is a subgraph that has more internal edges than outgoing ones. The community structure characterizes how well clustered a graph is. Community structure has been used to study all kinds of complex networks, such as social networks, for example, Facebook, the internet, and more recently, the graph of logical formulas, as well as an enormous number of other domains. So this is an example of a non-random formula taken from the SAT 2013 competition. As you can see, the graph is highly separable into the communities, which are represented with colored edges, and have relatively few inter-community edges, which are colored in black. If we compare this to the graph of a random formula, you can see it is much less separable, and there are far more inter-community edges. We refer to this as a giant hairy mess. So how do we go about computing the community structure for a graph? The algorithm, the decision version of the algorithm is NP-complete, but there are many approximate algorithms that have been proposed. For example, the closet Newman-Moore method and the online community detection algorithm. We use both of these algorithms in our experiments and get similar results with both of them, which has increased our confidence in our results. The modularity, or Q factor, of a graph lies between 0 and 1 and measures the quality of the communities, for example, by which we mean how separable are the communities in the graph. A higher Q implies that there's a good community structure with highly separable communities, whereas lower Q implies a bad community structure, the giant hairy mess we saw. We tested three hypotheses for this result, the first of which was we looked at seeing if there is a range of Q values for randomly generated formulas that are hard for SAT solvers regardless of the number of clauses or variables. We also looked to see if the randomly generated instances outside of this range were uniformly easy. For this experiment, we generated 550,000 SAT instances in which we varied the number of variables between 500 and 2,000 in increments of 100, the number of clauses between 2,000 and 10,000 in increments of 1,000, and the target Q between 0 and 1 in increments of 0.01. We also varied the number of target communities between 20 and 400. We then ran each of these instances multiple times in a random order on the mini SAT solver with a timer of 900 seconds per run. 900 seconds was the time I used for the SAT 2012 competition, and it was our initial baseline. When we got these results, we plotted Q against the time, and noticed that there was a significant increase in execution time when the Q ranged between 0.05 and 0.13. Unfortunately, our random generation technique did produce more instances within this range than outside of it. So to ensure that there wasn't a bias in our result, we also considered a stratified random sample, taking 250 instances from each 0.1 range of Q and saw almost an identical result. So this is a graph of the results that we had. And as you can see, in both the average and the stratified examples, there's this enormous peak range for the Q. The graph that shows all of the instances actually shows a double peak. This is separated by whether the formula was satisfiable or unsatisfiable, which was something that was quite interesting to us. The second experiment we looked at tested the hypothesis that the number of communities and the modularity of a formula is better correlated with the running time of a solver than traditional metrics, such as the number of clauses or the number of variables. We also wanted to know if the correlation was better for industrial instances or randomly generated or handcrafted ones. For this experiment, we used approximately 800 instances from the SAT 2013 competition. For the remaining instances, it wasn't possible to compute the community structure due to memory resource constraints. We used the online community detection algorithm as it's faster and more scalable than the closet Newman-Moore method. And we took the timing data from the SAT 2013 competition itself for the mini pure solver, and use a statistical tool called R to perform a standard linear regression. We performed this regression twice, once including the community structure metrics as well as the variables and clauses, and once without, and compared the adjusted R squared value from both experiments. The R squared value is a measure of how good the model is based on how much of the variability in the data is accounted for by the model. A higher R squared means that it's a better model, generally speaking. Unfortunately, a large number of the instances from the SAT competition timed out, approximately 60%, which led to the question of, do we include these instances and have possibly a biased result, or exclude them and not have enough data to run the result at all? Obviously, we decided to include them rather than not have a result at all. But to try and defend against this, we used the log of time rather than the standard time. This also helped protect against the fact that the instances which finished had a far lower solve time than those that timed out. There's a large gap between them. And we also standardized the data to have a mean of 0 and a standard deviation of 1. We do this as standard practice because the regression can sometimes assign a significance to a variable that isn't really there if the scales are too different. So the two models we considered, the first model included the community structure metrics and accounted for approximately half of the variability in the data. While this isn't a particularly great result, it is significantly better than any model that has existed in the past, such as the number of clauses, number of variables, and the clause-variable ratio, which only accounts for a third of the variability. In addition to looking at the R-squared results, we looked at the significance value for each of the terms in the model and noted that every one of the most significant terms either contained the number of communities or the Q value. A third and final result tested the hypothesis that the number of communities in a conflict clause is strongly correlated with its literal block distance measure. The LBD measure was first introduced in the glucose solver, and it's a measure of the distinct number of decision variables that a learnt clause contains. The lower the number of decision variables, the better the rank of the clause. The LBD is a powerful measure for the utility of a conflict clause, and the reason we care about this is because modern SAT solvers create an enormous number of conflict clauses while they're solving, and without clause deletion, these clauses would quickly consume all the available memory. This led to the question of which clauses to get deleted, for which LBD is an answer. The glucose solver periodically deletes clauses that have a bad LBD rank. The number of communities in a conflict clause is defined as the distinct number of communities that the variables in the clause belong to, so similar to the LBD. The intuition behind our hypothesis is that high-quality conflict clauses typically span very few communities. In addition to this, high-quality conflict clauses normally cause more propagation per decision variable and are hence likely to have a lower LBD, and we already knew that LBD picks out high-quality conflict clauses. We considered 189 industrial instances from the SAT 2013 competition out of a total of 300. For the remaining instances, we saw these memory errors. And for each of these 189 instances, we computed the community structure, the number of communities, and the LBD for each of the first 20,000 learned clauses. Beyond that, unfortunately, we had resource constraints. This led to an interesting question, as there were hundreds of thousands of data points to be considered across these 189 instances, and we had to decide how to analyze these results. We chose to use heat maps with a single heat map for an instance, with plotting the correlation between the number of communities and the LBD value of the learned clauses within that instance. This is an example of one of the heat maps. The LBD measure is along the x-axis, and the number of communities is along the y-axis. And as you can see, there's a very strong correlation between the two of them. So we are very happy with our results so far, but there is a large scope for improvement that will help us improve the confidence in our results. The first is we want to use a larger set of data. This is going to enable us to exclude the timeout results and improve our result overall. Unfortunately, there aren't very many larger sources of data than the SAT competition results, and these are not comparable with each other. Every year that the SAT competition changes, the computers used to calculate to run the solvers changes, the solvers themselves change, the instances change, and the timeout values change. So they aren't really comparable at all. We are in the process of running these instances on our own development machines, but this takes quite some time, as the timeout is set usually between 2 and 3 hours, and there's a lot of instances. We're also going to focus on individual categories within the SAT competition, such as either industrial or random or the hard combinatorial instances. The reason for this is we noticed during our regression that the overall R squared for the entire data set was sometimes lower than each of the individual categories. This suggests that the instances really are very different and that a different model should be used for each. We're looking at considering different regression techniques rather than a standard normal regression. This is because the non-normality of the data we are considering meant that it was almost impossible to estimate confidence intervals for our predictions. We're going to use more solvers as well. We've looked at the glucose solver, the mini pure solver, and the mini SAT solver, and seen that they all have very similar results. But these all stem from the same code base, so it makes sense that they would share some of the results. We're going to look next at Lingling and possibly some of the other parallel SAT solvers. And finally, we want to compare some different random generation techniques to ensure that ours is valid. This has led to some interesting directions for future work. We're going to consider in the future the graph representations, different graph representations, such as the clause instance graph rather than the variable instance graph. And we want to check whether it's possible to determine a highly predictive model. After this, we're going to look at comparing the community structure model that we have with graph width-based models. And we're going to look at other solver measures, for example, the memory usage and the conflict clause generation, rather than the time. We've built a visualization tool called SatGraph, which generated the graphics we saw earlier, but it also allows us to track the evolution of the community structure of a formula while it's being solved. So to conclude, the take-home message from this talk is that the community structure of a SAT instance strongly affects the solver performance. And we've seen this with three results, that the hard random instances have a queue between 0.05 and 0.13. The number of communities in the queue of a SAT instance is more predictive of mini-peer performance than other measures. And there is a strong correlation between the number of communities and the literal block distance in the glucose solver. That's the end of my talk. Thank you very much.
Any questions for Zack? Awesome. Thank you for the talk. Oh, please come up.
So most of the applications that you mentioned, like bounded model checking or concolic execution, what they do is they build up lots and lots of related formulas, right? They solve one, and you want it to be unsatisfiable to move on to the next one. Right, and so what you get is this, you know, set of incremental SAT formulas. How can you use this work in that space?
One way you could use this work is to look at how the structure of the formulas change. Every time you run the formula once and find something that didn't quite work, you would add a new set of constraints to it and rerun the formula a second time, and you'd keep going, of course. And you can look at how the structure of it evolves. We're more focused, though, on how you could convert an existing structured formula that is slow and turn it into one that a SAT solver can solve more efficiently. So rather than the ongoing pitch, we're looking at how to make each execution run faster. Okay.
Any questions on the moderator link? Okay. Thank you, Zack.